Hare Krishna Prabhu, it says that maybe I'll just log in because it says that the storage is almost full. So we have to delete some old recordings. So I'll probably go and check if we can delete one of the old classes and then we can start the recording. Sorry Prabhu for the delay.
Mataji, before you delete, can you please download Mataji, keep it talking?
What, Prabhu? What are you saying?
Before you delete, can you please download it first? Keep a local copy, Mataji.
Yeah, I've already downloaded all the recordings. I will mail it to all of you so that you
can sure.
Something. Yes,
I just want to make sure we don't lose anything. So.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mataji.
Maybe I'll go to some old class and I will, like in this conference call, some very old class which we all have recording and maybe remove that. Sorry for delaying everybody. Maybe I'll probably just try to delete one class.
But some of them are all in Dropbox, the older ones.
The old ones, that's why I thought, yeah.
Like the first five of them, like that, 10 of them, we can delete.
Yeah. Okay. Now we can, I'll again do recording begin. Let me start the recording again so that it's fresh and there is space. Okay. Now it's clean. We'll start off with the prayers. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Sri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Tapitam Yena Bhutale Sayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Jatapada Kamalam Sri Gurum Vaishnavamsha Sri Rupam Sakrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakhanvitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namavom Vishnupadaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschayate Deshakarine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Gaur Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So today we are in class number 5 of Brahma Samhita. Today we will cover verses 9 to 15. And especially these few verses, we are going to talk about creation. So before we begin on the verses, we'll do a quick revision of what we have seen so far. In class one, we did introduction to Brahma Samhita. What is Brahma Samhita? How the history of how Brahma Samhita was retrieved, and we saw a quick description of how Brahma Samhita is classified into different parts, how it discusses different topics, which is very similar to the Srimad Bhagavatam. So that was our class number one. Now, in class number two, we covered verses 1 and 2 of Brahma Samhita. The first verse is Ishvara Parama Krishna. We discussed how it is the Paribhasha Sutra and how it establishes the supremacy of Krishna. We also saw about, in verses 1 and 2, we saw about Goloka Vrindavan in general, how it is the supreme topmost planet and how Gokul and Goloka are non-different. And it is only the materialized that sees it as different. Both of the dhams are the same. Then in class 3, we discussed verses 3 and 4. In 3 and 4, we saw the central world of the residence of Radha Krishna in Goloka Vrindavan. We spoke about Yantra and Mantra, about Gopal Gayatri, how the Gopal Gayatri is inscribed in the Yantra. And we spoke about the Prakata and Aprakata Leelas and how to enter into this Aprakata Leela within Gokul Vrindavan or the Bhauma Vrindavan. How one enters into the Aprakata Leela, what is the procedure, how one does Mantra Upasana, and then how he enters the Swarasati stage. So we discussed that in verse 3, and in verse 4 we saw how the petals of this lotus, we first saw the inside world where Radha Krishna are standing. Then we saw how these petals are the different residences of the gopis. Mainly the first row of petals are the residences of the Ashtasakhis, and the further petals are the abode of the other residents of Vrindavan, other associates of Lord Krishna. In class number 4, we saw verses 5 and 6. So 5 and 6, very interesting verses. It speaks about the outer realm of Goloka Vrindavan, how the Chaturvyuha expansions, Pradyumna, Shankar, Sanani, Ruddha, Vasudeva, all of them are present in Goloka Vrindavan. And then we spoke about the different Vedas and the Purusharthas in their purest forms. Like we spoke about the four Vedas, how they are in the purest form, and about Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha in the Goloka Vrindavan region. And besides that, we also saw in detail about the mysterious region of Shweta Dweep, where Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu resides. So there was a lot of description about Shweta Dweep, where Shweta Dweep was located, and the pastimes of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who resides there. Then we also saw about the different jewels and the Trishulas that is guarding the dham, Goloka Vrindavan, and how it prevents unqualified people from entering Goloka Vrindavan. And in verse number 6, we began to see about the internal potency of the Lord. We spoke about Yogamaya and how she facilitates the pastime of Krishna. And not only that, she also helps the devotees to progress in Krishna consciousness. So we spoke about the role of Yogamaya. Then in class number 5, we covered verses 7 and 6. So verses 7 and 6 were discussed in detail. The topic that was discussed in verse 7 and 6 was about the Lord's external potency, about Maya or Durga or Chaya, however we want to call her. It speaks about the Lord's external potency and how Mahavishnu, we came to a point of creation actually from verse 7 onwards. Till verse 6, we were mainly seeing Goloka Vrindavan, the description of the spiritual planet of Goloka Vrindavan, and so many details about this place and how one enters the Prakata, Prakata Leela. We were getting into a lot of details about the spiritual world. Now, that was part A of the discussion of Brahma Samhita verses 1 to 6. So once we completed that, we came into the process of creation from verse number 7. So in verse number 7, once we talk about creation, we begin with the external energy of the Lord. So we introduce the external energy of the Lord, and then we came to the introduction of Mahavishnu. So Mahavishnu's external energy is the creative potency, and his internal energy is known as Rama Devi, or she is also known as Yogamaya. Rama Devi or Yogamaya or Yoga Nidra. I wanted to say Yoga Nidra. Of course, she is Yogamaya, but still, specifically, she is Yoga Nidra. Okay, So we were talking about Lord Mahavishnu reclining in the Viraja River, and he's having this pastimes with his internal potency known as Rama Devi, and he's relishing these pastimes. And because of this conjugal relationship that they are enjoying, actually that is the source of all creation. Out of compassion for all living entities, he begins to create. The desire that he has to facilitate, a place for the living entities, that desire is the result of the creation of the material world. So we discussed that. Then we saw about how he begins to create, how he glances on his external energy, but the glance is indirect because in his glance, it has a dim halo, or how we describe the torchlight, right? So there is a beam of light, and there in the outside there is a dim halo. Okay, so that dim halo is compared to Shambhu, or it is Shambhu. And Shambhu actually contacts Maya. So we described this in detail, how actually Shambhu contacts Maya, and how Shambhu is actually he is like an expansion of the Lord, but still he is not the Lord. So we discussed that also. Now how there is a difference between Shambhu and Vishnu or Mahavishnu. Then this Shambhu, he contacts the external energy Maya. And then we spoke about Pradhan. Pradhan is like the cooked down soup, like we were talking the other day. It is like all the elements mixed up together. And Mahatattva is the separated elements. Like when these elements separate out, then the vegetables and all is like rewind process. When you see all the vegetables and other things in its original form, and the elements are separated, that is like the Mahatattva. So we had a lot of discussion, and we went through many examples of how the difference between Pradhan and Mahatattva, and how the glance of Mahavishnu actually agitates the Pradhan, and we saw how the Pradhan transforms into Mahatattva. Then we also saw how the glance of Mahavishnu has two aspects to it. One of the aspects is known as Mahavishnu, and the other aspect is known as Advaita Acharya. So the glance that contacts Maya is known as Mahavishnu, and the glance that agitates the Pradhan is known as Advaita Acharya. So we saw that also in that verse in the previous class. That was verse number seven. Verse number 7 and 8. Yeah, so verse number 7. And then verse number 8 got into the introduction of how basically Shambhu and Maya are the father and mother of this universe, and they are the immediate cause, because they are the mother and father of this universe. It's only because of their union, the material creation has begun. Material creation begins, but the union itself was a result of the desire of Mahavishnu. So the original cause is Mahavishnu, but the immediate cause or the union that happened was between Shiva and Parvati, or Shambhu and Maya, and that's why we worship them as our mother and father, who are the father and mother of this particular creation. So we saw up to here, we saw the glance of Mahavishnu, Mahavishnu's glance contacting, transforming into Shambhu, contacting Maya, and we spoke about Pradhan and Mahatattva. So we have only seen so much, okay? And this has been up till verse number 8. Now, from verses 9 to 15, we are going to get into further material creation. Okay, so first I'll read verse number 9. लिंगयोनि आत्मिक जाता इमा महेश्वरी प्रजा लिंगा ऑफ द मंडेन मैस्कुलिन जनरेटिव ऑर्गन्स योनि एंड ऑफ द मंडेन फेमिनिन जनरेटिव ऑर्गन्स आत्मिका इज द एम्बॉडीमेंट जाता बॉर्न इमा दिस महेश्वरी ऑफ द कॉन्सर्ट ऑफ द ग्रेट लॉर्ड ऑफ दिस मंडेन वर्ल्ड प्रजा द ऑफस्प्रिंग ट्रांसलेशन All offspring of the consort of the great Lord Maheshwara of this mundane world are of the nature of the embodiment of the mundane masculine and feminine generative organs. So this is a continuation of the process of creation that is explained. So in the first of all, before we get into further process, we should understand in the spiritual world, first we have Krishna, then we have Krishna's expansion Balram, And then we spoke about the first Chaturvyuha, where we have Sankarsana, Pradyumna, Aniruddha, Vasudeva, of which Sankarsana is the most potent. And from Sankarsana, there is Narayana in the Vaikuntha realm. And from Narayana, there is Mahasankarsana. Okay, just like we have the Chaturvyuha in the Goloka Vrindavan, we have the same Chaturvyuha, Pradyumna, Aniruddha, Sankarsana, Vasudeva, in the Vaikuntha realm also. So this is the second Chaturvyuha. It is called as the Maha Chaturvyuha. Maha Sankarsana, that particular Sankarsana of the second Chaturvyuha is called as Maha Sankarsana. From this Maha Sankarsana, we have Mahavishnu. Okay, so that's like the order of how the expansions come. So we didn't talk about it in the previous classes, so I'm giving you the order of how the expansions come. So after Mahasankarsana, we have Mahavishnu. So this Mahavishnu is actually sleeping in the ocean, in this Karana ocean, and he is responsible for creation. Now Shiva and Maya, or Shambhu and Maya, they represent the prototype of all reproductive processes. Okay, that is happening in the material world. Now the Shivalinga is actually, or Lord Shiva is the male principle of creation, and Maya is the womb, or the yoni that receives the male principle, the womb of material nature, or she embodies the female principle. So this verse talks about worshipping Lord Shiva in this capacity as the cause of the universe. So we say the humans, demigods, plants, animals, all of them, they embody the male and the female principle. See, generally, cultured people, we don't talk about these topics concerning generative parts. But here, we have a very high-level scripture, very, very high-level scripture that talks about this. So when the British actually figured out what the Shivalinga is, they were like, oh, look at these Indians. How can they, look at what they are worshipping. They are so, it's a kind, very perverted kind of thought they had. Well, look at what these Indians are worshipping. But actually, when we understand what in reality it is supposed to represent, when we understand that it is a manifestation of Mahavishnu and his mercy on the conditioned souls and a part of the greater process of functioning of the material nature, the cycle of material nature, when we actually understand this in a right way, it becomes very, very important and valuable. Actually, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he writes in the purport, very interestingly, he makes this remark. He says, indecorum is merely an entity pertaining to the external custom of society. But science, and specifically the highest science, cannot destroy the true entity by deference to social custom. Therefore, in order to demonstrate the seed of mundane sex desire, the basic principle of this phenomenal world, the use of those identical words is indispensable. By the use of all these words, only the masculine energy or the predominating active potency and the female energy or the predominated active potency are to be understood. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati is making it clear here that we should not think of it in a perverted sense. Just like look at how a medical student studies the human body, or how the doctors and the nurses see the human body every day. In that sense, it is not something to look at with disgust or embarrassment, but they are looking at it at a scientific point of view. So similarly, here we are looking at the highest science, and we are looking at it at a transcendental platform with respect to the Supreme Lord and His potency. So it is wholesome, and it is the topmost transcendental subject. Only when the male and female generative principles are inside the realm of this material world, it is perverted. Because this world itself is a perverted reflection of the of the spiritual world. Just like last class we had Ganapati Krishna Prabhu, he was telling how the desire of the Lord, such a pure desire. He's having so much desire, nice desire for, and he wants to facilitate the living entities. But this desire is seen as a perverted reflection in the material world as false ego. It is so contaminated. So similarly, in the original spiritual sense, when we talk about male and female generative principles, it is not supposed to be taken in a contaminated way. Rather, that is the original principle that has started this material creation. That union between the Shivalinga and the yoni, or Durga is actually the result of this material creation. So that's the reason in verse number 9, we talk about generative organs, and this should be purely taken in a spiritual sense. And that is also very nicely described by Dr. Siddhanta Saraswati in the first book. So that is verse number 9. We'll go to verse number 10. Shaktiman Purusha Yoyam Linga Rupi Maheshwara Tasmin Avirbhulinge Mahavishnur Jagatpati. Translation. The person embodying the material casual principle, which is the great lord of this mundane world, Maheshwara, Shambhu, in the form of the male generating organ, is joined to his female consort, the limited energy Maya, as the efficient causal principle. The lord of the world, Mahavishnu, is manifest in him by his subjective portion in the form of his glands. So again, this is only a continuation of what we have spoken, but there is a little more elaboration. It says that Shambhu is the material causal principle, and he has the potency to affect the change within matter. Okay, he has the potency to affect the change. Whereas Maya is the efficient causal principle. That means she has the capacity to be changed. Even in the material sense, we see that the male principle of the living entity cannot do anything much without the egg. Only when it unites with the egg, some reproduction takes place. So similarly, the egg cannot do anything without the male principle. So here, it is only by their union. One is the, one has the capacity to cause the change, and the other one has the capacity to be changed. So that is described in this verse. Shambhu is the male principle and Maya is the female principle. So it is only because of Shambhu that Maya gets agitated. So that is described here. And the other point here that we should understand is that Mahavishnu is the ultimate cause of which Shambhu and Maya. They both are completely dependent on Mahavishnu. So this whole principle of the union of Shambhu and Maya cannot happen without the desire of Mahavishnu. So he is the primary cause. These are all only secondary causes. They are completely dependent on him, on his desire, on his conjugal relationship with Rama Devi. They are completely dependent on that. Whereas he is completely independent of them. So that's why we always say that Mahavishnu never contacts the material world, because he is completely independent of them, whereas these people are dependent on him. Okay? Now, verse number 11. These are all very short verses, so we'll cover to verse number 15 today. Okay? Verse number 11. Sahasra Sirisha Purushah Sahasraksha Sahasrapat Sahasrabahur Vishwatma Sahasramsha Sahasrasuhu. Sahasra Sirisha, possessing thousands of heads, Purushah, Lord Mahavishnu, the first Purusha Avatara. Sahasraksha, possessing thousands of eyes. Sahasrapat, possessing thousands of legs. Sahasrabahu, possessing thousands of arms. Vishwatma, the super soul of the universe. Sahasramsha, the source of thousands of avatars. Sahasrasuhu, the creator of thousands of individual souls. Actually, I think this verse, many of you, at least the first part of the verse, you must have heard a million times. Sahasra Sirisha Purushaha, you must have heard this many times. We'll get into it. Anyway, translation. This lord of the mundane world, Mahavishnu, possesses thousands and thousands of heads and eyes and hands. He is the source of thousands and thousands of avatars in his thousands and thousands of subjective portions. He is the creator of thousands and thousands of individual souls. So 11 to 14 is going to describe, now we have started verse number 11. 11 to 14 is going to describe in detail about Mahavishnu and further creation process. Now here it describes Mahavishnu as a very big man. He's all powerful, and all the souls begin to emanate from him, although they are always eternal. So we should understand that the souls are always eternal. And we discussed in the previous class how the souls are actually in a suspended state. So they are eternal. But the souls begin to emanate from him when the creation, recreation begins. Okay, when the creation is again cyclic. So when the creation is beginning, the souls begin to emanate from him. Actually, the Purusha Sukta prayers, that's what we always, when we hear the Purusha Sukta prayers, it becomes like the Sahasra Sirisha Purushaha Sahasraksha Sahasrapat You must have heard this, at least in audio, in many places. So the Purusha Sukta prayers, they begin with this verse, actually. The first part of this verse that we recited in Brahma Samhita, the first two lines, they are the beginning of the Purusha Sukta verses. So when do we hear the Purusha Sukta prayers? The demigods actually chant the Purusha Sukta prayers. So the demigods, they go to the ocean of milk and they pray actually to Lord Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu to descend to this world. Okay, so the Purusha Sukta prayers, when the demigods go and sing, they are actually singing to Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu. But here, in this verse, it talks about the Karuna the Kashayi Vishnu being this, Sahasra Sirisha Purusha. This prayer is given to Karuna the Kashayi Vishnu. So that's pretty interesting. Because we should understand, in principle, all the three Vishnus are the same entity, but they are named differently in relation to their function. But they are actually one and the same, and therefore, sometimes they are used interchangeably and it is not a mistake. One might think Brahma Samhita is making a mistake. These prayers are meant for Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu, because whenever any incarnation, and also this verse spoke about an incarnate being the Karuna the Kashayi Vishnu being the source of all incarnations. But what have we heard? We hear that when the different incarnations or when the different forms of the Lord descend from the spiritual world to the material world, they come through Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu. That's what we have heard, right? So here it describes Mahavishnu as being the source of all incarnations. This is not false, because Mahavishnu and Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu are actually the same. Okay, they are the same, one and the same. But yet, with respect to their function, they are different. It is the same personality. Same entity, but difference is in relation to their function. So at many places, they will be used interchangeably. Even in the Bhagavatam, there are some verses that suddenly describe of Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu in the sense of Karuna the Kashayi Vishnu. So we should not get confused. It is okay to see such interchanging ways of describing these two lords. And here in this verse, we see that Mahavishnu appears, you know, like we see Sahasra Sirisha Purusha. That means Mahavishnu has thousands of heads. But how do we see Mahavishnu in the picture that you must have seen today, the picture that we sent through WhatsApp? How does he look like? He looks like one person with a single head and just two arms or maybe four arms, right? That's it, four arms maybe at the most. But we don't see him with multiple heads or thousands of heads the way it is described here. We don't see him with thousands of arms. We don't see Sahasrabahu. So we should understand that this Mahavishnu, who is reclining in the ocean of milk in the Virajanadi, is actually the source of everything. The source of the different incarnations, as it is mentioned here, from him all the incarnations are coming. Not only that, from him all the Garbho the Kashayi Vishnus in all the universes. There are so many universes emanating from the pores of Mahavishnu as he exhales. That also we have seen. So when all the universes come, in all the universes there are going to be Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu in the ocean of milk, and we are also going to have Garbho the Kashayi Vishnu, who is reclining in the bottom of the universe, from whose navel Brahma is going to appear. We have not gone there still. But in principle, we understand that from this Mahavishnu, so many universes are coming. That means from him, so many Kshiro the Kashayi Vishnu, so many Garbho the Kashayi Vishnu, and from the Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu, so many incarnations in each and every universe are all emanating. So in that sense, this Mahavishnu is described, and also, not only that, forget the different forms of the Lord, even so many entities within each and every universe, so many millions and trillions and whatnot, how many multiple number of entities, living entities are being created by the mercy of the Lord. So like this, in this sense, because he is the super soul between each Atma, though each soul is unique and different, though each soul is not the same as the Supreme Lord, we are one and different from the Lord. I mean, we are simultaneously one but different. Still, he is the Paramatma between inside each one of us. So in that sense, the Shiro the Kashayi Vishnu actually expands into the different Paramatmas. So in that sense, you can describe this Lord as Sahasra Sirisha Purusha, Sahasraksha Sahasrabahu, because he is that one person who has so many forms and so many heads and so many hands. So that's how this verse is explained. Everything comes from Mahavishnu. Even the incarnations that come from the spiritual world are actually descending from Mahavishnu. Actually, how it is described is quite interesting. It says that even the incarnations, it is when they come to this material world, the Vaya media, we always hear of the Vaya media as being Kshira Dakshaya Vishnu. But actually the incarnations are also coming from the body of Mahavishnu. Then only they enter Kshira Dakshaya Vishnu. Then only from Kshira Dakshaya Vishnu they come into each universe, actually. Like, except for, for example, you have so many forms of the Lord in the spiritual world. Like, in the Vaikunthas itself, you have Narasimha, Vamana, Varaha, all of them, they have their spiritual abodes, all the forms of the Lord, they have their spiritual abodes. So all of them, when the universe is emanating, or whenever it is time for them to come, they are also emanating from Mahavishnu only, okay, from this Lord who is sleeping in the Viraja ocean, or the Karnodakashayi ocean. From him only they are coming. But sometimes, and also he's like a gateway. They come through him and they go back through him. But there are some incarnations, this is actually discussed in one of the lectures, that there are some incarnations which are temporary. Some incarnations of the Lord, they don't have a permanent abode in the spiritual world. And two of such incarnations are mentioned by Prabhupada. One is Hamsa Avatara, and the other one is Mohini Avatara. These two are described. There could be many more also, we don't know. But as we know two incarnations that actually don't have a permanent spiritual abode in the spiritual world. So these incarnations, when they are not coming, they actually repose in Mahavishnu. When they are coming also, they have to come through Mahavishnu, but they go back and they repose in Mahavishnu. So that is something that is described in this verse. So they stay within Mahavishnu when they don't have planets, when they don't have spiritual planets in the spiritual sky. And this Mahavishnu is the creator of thousands of individual souls, or he is the resting place of all individual souls, and including the resting place of certain incarnations that don't have spiritual realms. They don't have spiritual realms in the spiritual world. For such incarnations, they go and they repose in the body of Mahavishnu, these incarnations like Hamsa and Mohini, actually. And this Lord, he oversees the living entities as Kshira Dakshaya Vishnu. So this Lord, he expands himself later as Kshira Dakshaya Vishnu, and he is going to be the Paramatma and he will oversee everyone. So this is the process. So the main points in this verse that we should understand is that in verse number 11 is that Mahavishnu sometimes interchangeably recognized as Kshira Dakshaya Vishnu. Sometimes even Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is interchangeably recognized as Kshira Dakshaya Vishnu in Bhagavatam. So when we see such anomalies, we should not think it is wrong. It's more like it is the same person who's performing different functions. That's all. That's how we understand it. Okay? So that is verse number 11. Now verse number 12. Narayana sa bhagavan apastasmat sanatanat avirasit karanano nidhihi sankarshanatmaka yoganitram gatastasmin sahasram shaswayam mahan. Narayana, named Narayana, sa, that, Bhagavan, Supreme Personality of Godhead, Mahavishnu, apaha, water, tasmat, from that, Sanatanat, eternal person, avirasit, has sprung, karana arana, the causal ocean, nidhi, expanse of water, sankarshana atmaka, the subjective portion of sankarshan, yoga nidram gata, in the state of deep sleep, tasman, in that water, sahasramshava, thousands of portions, Swayam, himself, Mahan, the Supreme Person, translation. The same Mahavishnu is spoken of by the name Narayana in this mundane world. From that eternal person has sprung the vast expanse of water of the spiritual causal ocean. The subjective portion of Sankarshan, who abides in Param Vyoma, the above Supreme Purusha with thousands of subjective portions, reposes in the state of divine sleep, yoga nidra, in the waters of the spiritual causal ocean. Purport, yoga nidra, divine sleep, is spoken of as an ecstatic trance, which is of the nature of bliss of the true subjective personality. The above mentioned Ramadevi is yoga nidra in the form of yoga maya. I think, again, this was also we have discussed in the previous discussions, we have covered this, but still we'll get into a little more elaboration of verse number 12. Now, it says Mahavishnu is sometimes known as Narayana. Whatever we know so far is that Narayana means the personality in the spiritual world in Vaikuntha, Lakshmi Narayana are residing. And when the creation has to happen, the same person, he expands into the three Vishnus. So the three Vishnus are to do with the material world, material creation, functioning, all that. All the three Vishnus, Karanodakshaya Vishnu, Shirodakshaya Vishnu, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, all of them. But as we, but the name Narayana, we always refer to the person in the spiritual world. Okay, who's the source of these three Mahavishnus? From him comes the second Shankarsan or the Mahashankarsan, and from him comes the three Vishnus. This is how we understand generally. But here in this verse, in verse number 12, it says that Mahavishnu is sometimes known as Narayana. So why? Why is he sometimes known as Narayana? There are three reasons. Because Narayana, you can split that Narayana into Nara and Ayana. That means he is the resting place for all Naras, all living entities. Right? So Mahavishnu is actually the resting place for all living entities. We just saw how all the jivas are actually in a suspended state in the body of Mahavishnu. We also saw how some of the incarnations, in fact, of the Lord that do not have spiritual planets are actually reposing in Mahavishnu. So like that, he is the source, I mean, he is the reclining place or he is the resting place for all living entities. And also, he is the shelter for further expansion. The second reason is also because he is the seer or witness of all creation of the mundane world. And not only that, he is called as Narayana because he is the one who has the residence lying in the waters. Narayana means one who sleeps in the waters, and hence his name is Narayana. So the Mahavishnu that who is sleeping, the Karanodakshaya Vishnu, can also be known as Narayana because of these reasons. And this is actually described in the prayers of Lord Brahma in the 10th canto, 14th chapter of Bhagavatam. Actually, Brahma talks about this. He talks about this as how the name Narayana is actually befitting to him, to the Supreme Lord. So he talks about this. So this Mahavishnu is also sometimes known as Narayana. And this is the Narayana of the mundane world. So as the verse says, he is sometimes known as Narayana in this mundane world. But this Narayana also, the Mahavishnu also, doesn't have any contact with matter, but he is in charge of the creation. But at the same time, he is not the Narayana of Vaikuntha. So he is an expansion of the Narayana from Vaikuntha. So this is how we understand this verse, when it indicates that Narayana is Mahavishnu. That means how we understand this, we understand it in terms of the meaning of Narayana. Because he is reclining in the causal ocean, he is reclining in the waters of the causal ocean, and also all the living entities are reposing in him, and also he is the witness or for everything that is happening in the creation in this mundane world. Hence he is known as Narayana. Okay? So generally, he is in a state of sleep because the topic of Yoga Nidra is also brought about in this verse. So here, generally, he is in a state of sleep. And this sleep is not like any mundane sleep. It's a divine mystic slumber. It's an ecstatic trance. It's an experience of bliss with its pleasure potency. And explicitly here in this verse, it is mentioned that this Yoga Nidra is Rama Devi. So as we discussed in the previous class, Rama Devi is inside of Mahavishnu. Like in the picture, in that Goloka chart picture, we see Rama Devi sitting in a lotus sitting outside. That is more for our understanding that she is sitting outside. See, when you see Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, you will see Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, Rama Devi is massaging his feet. Inside the universe, you see Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, who is reclining down, from whose navel the universe is springing up. From Brahma is coming out from his navel, right? That Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, you will see his internal potency of Lakshmi Devi is actually massaging his feet. She is outside. But whereas this Mahavishnu, who is in the Karana ocean, technically his internal potency is inside. And she is in the form of Yoga Nidra. He is enjoying Yoga Nidra there. And her name is Rama Devi. Actually, she is not outside. For our understanding, the painting shows her as outside. Okay? So he is enjoying his pastimes there. This is verse number 12. Now we'll go to verse number 13. See, most of these verses are actually a repetition of what we discussed in the previous class, but it's just making things more clear and getting into more details. That's not. In verse number 13. Tadroma bilajalishu bijam sankarshanaya cha haimani andani jatani maha bhutavratani tu. Translation. The spiritual seeds of sankarshan existing in the pores of the skin of Mahavishnu are born as so many golden sperms. These sperms are covered with five great elements. So this verse gets into the details of how the universes are coming out from the bodily pores of Mahavishnu. They are like sperms actually that are coming out from the bodily pores of Mahavishnu, and they are in the form of yellow bubbles. And these are going to make up the universes. If you see the picture of the chart that I've sent, you can see golden bubbles coming out, yellow color bubbles that are coming out, right? So these yellow color bubbles are going to form the universes. They are going to be covered by the material elements, and then you have these beautiful universes. Now, at this point, we should understand that though we got an introduction about Garbhodakshayi Vishnu, Garbhodakshayi Vishnu has not yet entered. Though we spoke about Garbhodakshayi Vishnu, Shirodakshayi Vishnu, all of them, still they have not yet entered. They will enter much later. They are still in verse number 13. So we'll see what happens in verse number 13. So these yellow bubbles, they are like universes, and the seed of the universe, or the seeds of the universes, they are not the complete universe, they are the seeds, okay? The universe is still not formed. These seeds of the universes, what happens is, from the bodily pores of Mahavishnu, they go flying, you know, like particles from the screen of a window. Have you seen during sunrise, you know, when you open the blinds, when you open the window blinds, you will see small particles that are coming through the rays of the sun that enter your house. So like that, like through the pores of the screen, you will see nice small particles that are coming, dirt particles. Like that, from the body of Mahavishnu, from the pores of his skin, so many particles or so many seeds or so many universes, these yellow bubbles, they go flying out. Just like that, into the accommodating part. What is the accommodating part? The womb. The womb is Maya, right? So the creative principle. They all get into the accommodating part, Maya Devi, Maya or material universe. And they entered there with the exhalation of Mahavishnu. Okay? When Mahavishnu exhales, when he exhales out, these particles, they are going to come out of the skin of the Mahavishnu. And they entered the chamber of Maya. And once they enter the chamber, they become enlarged by the great non-conglomerate elements of earth, water, fire, air, and ether. Okay? So it says they become enlarged by the elements of earth, water, fire, air, ether. So these elements are described as non-conglomerates. That means initially, first in the first case we saw Prabhan, right? Initially everything was like a soup, it was all combined. Then by the glance of Mahavishnu, they are going to be separated. Now when these seeds or these golden sperms are entering, what happens? These elements, they begin to envelop these seeds, and these sperms, they become larger and larger and larger. It's like a small yellow bubble. You see down how the yellow bubble has become so big, and inside so many things are happening. Like that, these yellow bubbles that are emanating from the body of Mahavishnu, when they contact the chamber, or the accommodating chamber, what happens is all these elements, they start enveloping these golden sperms, okay? So these elements begin to envelop these seeds and they become enlarged. Now at this point, these elements are still not cooperating. They are called as non-conglomerate. That means they are still not cooperating. So it's like an automobile parts, okay? You know the different, many of you must have seen different parts of the automobile. So when they are not put together in right assembly, what happens? You don't get a proper car, right? If supposing the tires are not fixed properly or the engine is not put in the right place, the seats are not put in the right place, then you're not getting a proper vehicle. So like that, these parts are not combining properly. They are not cooperating with each other. Why are they not cooperating with each other? Because they are also personalities. Everything is personal. Everything in spiritual science, each and everything is personal. Personal. Even the elements, they all have predominating deities. So they are all disconnected. They feel kind of unassembled because they are personified and they have controlling deities. all these controlling VPs are not cooperating. Okay? So at this point, what is going to happen? These controlling deities are going to go and pray to Mahavishnu. They are going to go and pray to this Mahavishnu because unless there is a proper intelligence to put them together, they will not cooperate. And who is this intelligence? This intelligence is the creator. It is Mahavishnu. So these elements that are going to participate in creation, these controlling deities are actually going to go and pray to Mahavishnu. We will not go there, but still, we should understand this at this point. So these universes, they get filled with the ingredients of material nature and they expand. And this is going on for eons and eons of time. Okay, all these universes, they are not cooperating. There is so much confusion. And they're just expanding. All the materials are covering. Just to cover up the seeds, just to cover up these bubbles, it's going to take millions and millions of years. Like this, all these universes are floating in the causal ocean for a while. Okay? So we pause here. This is verse number 13. The remaining, what happens after that, how the predominating deities are going to go speak to Mahavishnu, all that we are not going to see now. All that will be seen after verse number 19. So there is a pause here. Now you just visualize this. You think that the golden sperms have come out, the bubbles are coming out, and the elements are trying to cover up, but there is no cooperation. We are expanding, and this is going on for thousands and thousands and thousands of eons. Okay? So the next part of it will be explored in text number 19. But for today, we're going to go to text number 14 next. What happens in text 14? Text number 14. Pratiyandam evam ekamshat vishati swayam Sahasramurta Vishwatma Mahavishnu Sanatana. Translation. The same Mahavishnu entered into each universe as his own separate subjective portions. The divine portions that entered into each universe are possessed of his majestic extension. That is, they are the eternal universal soul Mahavishnu possessing thousands and thousands of heads. Purport. Mahavishnu lying in the spiritual causal ocean is a subjective portion of Mahasankarshan. We already discussed that. He entered as his own subjective portions into those universes. These individual portions all represent the second divine Purusha lying in the ocean of conception and is identical with Mahavishnu in every aspect. He is also spoken of as a divine guide from within of all souls. So verse number 14 actually gives an introduction of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. Now Garbhodakshaya Vishnu comes into picture. Now both Mahavishnu and Garbhodakshaya Vishnu are the same person, but they are the eternal universal soul Mahavishnu, but they separate into many universes. That is the subjective portion of Mahavishnu, who is the eternal universal guide, universal soul of everything. He is going to separate out as Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, and the subjective portions are going to enter many, many universes. Okay? They just give an introduction of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, who he is, but still Garbhodakshaya Vishnu hasn't entered. The material creation hasn't begun, right? Like, I mean, inside, these elements are still not cooperating. Thousands and thousands of ages are going on now. We are at that point. So here an introduction of who Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is given. This character has not yet entered. He has just been introduced. His biodata is given to us. Okay. So next, from Karnodakshaya Vishnu, we are going to get Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. Now in verse 15, we are going to also see about Kshirodakshaya Vishnu. Then only in verse 19, we'll see about how they enter and all the drama that happens and how material creation actually begins. Okay. Verse number 15. Vamanagar Asrajat Vishnum Dakshinagat Prajapatin Jyotirlingamayam Shambhum Kurcha Deshat Avasrajat. Translation. The same Mahavishnu created Vishnu from his left limb, Brahma, the first progenitor of all beings, from his right limb, and from the space between his two eyebrows, Shambhu, the divine masculine, manifested halo. Okay, so this is interesting because if you just read the verse without any purport or without anything, you'll go crazy because it says the same Mahavishnu from his left limb, another Vishnu comes out. Then it says from his right limb, Brahma is coming out, And then from the central office, I thought Shambhu was coming. Now, we go, without purpose, it's very difficult to understand what Brahma Samhita is trying to convey here. So we all know, we've always heard that Lord Shiva appears from the middle of the eyebrows of Brahma, right? And how did Brahma appear? We have heard, we have always heard Brahma comes from the navel of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. Now, at this point, still these elements are fighting. We have not even cooperated. Garbhodakshaya Vishnu has not even entered. Where is the question of Brahma here? So who are these characters that we will see in this verse? In the previous verse, the character of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu was introduced. Now, in this verse, the other characters are getting introduced. So we will see about them. Now, here, in verse number 15, Shambhu's manifesting has become more clear. Okay, it says that he comes from the space between the eyebrows of Mahavishnu. So take this first thing. Now, it also says from the left limb of Vishnu and the from the left limb of Mahavishnu, Vishnu is created, and from the right limb of Mahavishnu, Brahma or Prajapati is created. Who is this Brahma? Who is this Brahma? Living entities have not yet entered, right? So this Brahma is the Hiranyagarbha Brahma or the prototype of all Brahmas. So Hiranyagarbha Brahma or the prototype Brahma is the principal, seminal principle of all the Brahmas in each and every universe. He has nothing to do with the four-headed Brahma or the five-headed Brahma or the ten-headed Brahma of the universes that are getting created. So many, we talk about so many universes. Each universe is of a different size. Our universe has a four-headed Brahma. Some other universe has 10, some has 20, some has 15, some has 100. We talk about these things, right? So this prototype Brahma has nothing to do with any of those Brahmas. He is a prototype. From him only, the principle of the other Brahmas is acquired. That is, the other Brahmas come from this Brahma. They are actually expanding from him. The other Brahmas of each universe. So he is the prototype. Hiranyagarbha is the sum total of the passionate creative potency within the entire material creation. And as the creation goes on, Lord Brahma appears and Hiranyagarbha gives his potency to each and every Brahma of the universe so that they are able to create further. So the sum total of the creative potency is with this prototype, Brahma. Who is coming from where? He is coming from the right side of Mahavishnu. He is created there. From the left side, who comes? Who comes from the left side? Shirodakshaya Vishnu is coming. And from the center of his eyebrows, Shambhu is coming. Okay. So now let's see the left limb. From the left limb, Shirodakshaya Vishnu is created, or rather, he is expanded. Okay. So this Shirodakshaya Vishnu is the one who is going to enter each and every universe, and he is going to reside in the ocean of milk. And from the respective Shirodakshaya Vishnus of the universe, each and every living entity will get their super soul, or rather not get, but the super soul will come and accompany each and every living entity. Okay, it says that Shambhu is manifested in the space between his between the two eyebrows of this Mahavishnu. Now, again, here again I'll make it clear. The Shiva that appears from the forehead of Brahma in each universe is not this Shambhu. This Shambhu is the prototype. Okay? This Shambhu is not within every universe. This Shambhu is beyond Lord Shiva, beyond the 11 Rudras of every universe. And he's beyond the he's beyond Shiva of each universe. And this Shambhu is again a prototype. So what potency does he have? Just like how Brahma has the seminal creating energy, similarly, Shambhu has the capacity for developing false ego. Everything is, the source is actually with Shambhu. Okay, Shambhu is the prototype there. And how, when Shambhu actually appears between the eyebrows of Mahavishnu, this Shambhu, his appearance is from here. Then he gets in the glands, actually. That's how he comes out. He comes out first from the eyebrows, and he's the one who gets into the glands, and then he forms a dim halo who contacts Maya. So the source of this Shambhu, how did he come out? How did this glands have a halo? That is described here. He actually comes from the eyebrows of Mahavishnu. Okay? Not only that, so we saw a prototype Shambhu, we saw a prototype Brahma. Okay? Not only that, But also, there are prototypes of all other demigods, like sun god, Indra, air god, fire god, etc. Prajapati god, everybody has a prototype. Okay? And this is not described in Brahma Samhita in this verse, but it is described in Srimad Bhagavatam. I think in Canto 2 it is described. So Srimad Bhagavatam talks about the different prototypes. So all the prototypes are produced here. They are dislocated parts. Okay, that means they are not the Supreme Lord. They are dislocated parts and they have delegated powers. Okay, and Vishnu is the delegator. Vishnu is giving the delegation. So the elements didn't combine. So the elements get together and pray to the Lord that they are not able to combine. They are not able to function. We cannot cooperate. So help us. So in Srimad Bhagavatam, there's a nice verse where before even creation begins, all the demigods are going and praying to Mahavishnu. How is it possible? Because there are prototypes. Okay? So the demigods go and pray, and then creation begins. And from these prototypes, actually the individual universes receive their Brahmas, receive their Shivas, and they receive their demigods and everyone. So this is verse number 15. So I'll stop here. That's all we have for today. So we have covered till verse number 15. So if you have any comments, leave, open it for discussion. Hare Krishna. And if I don't know any answers, I request all of you to help me because this was really difficult. Yeah. Thank you so much, Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol Mataji, Pranam.
Hare Bol, Hare Krishna, Dandavat, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Mataji, you are meant about introduction. Even the introduction is so much, so mind-boggling. It's amazing. I'm sure if we get to the core, it will be really very inspiring. One thing you mentioned, Mataji, I would like you to repeat that so that I can hear that for my purification. You mentioned about Narayana, no? The meaning of the word Narayana. Could you explain that again, Mataji?
Okay, actually Bhagavatam gives these meanings in that Canto 10, verse 14. I just wrote it down. He's known as Narayana for three reasons. Brahma's prayers, Brahma explains this. Because he's the resting place for all living entities. And he is the shelter of further expansions. That is number one. Actually, this is the second reason, but I couldn't comprehend it in Sanskrit, like why it is like that. The second reason is that he is the seer or witness of all creation in the mundane world. I don't know how that relates to Narayana. Maybe he's looking at the, he's overseeing the living entities, hence he's known as Narayana. And the third one is one who has a residence or lying in the waters. One who lies in the waters is known as Narayana.
One who lies in the water.
Third one is one who lies in the waters. Yeah.
So that is why we sometimes say Vishnu-tattva expansions is Narayana. Is that the reason?
That's why we say Mahavishnu is Narayana sometimes.
Narayana. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Revata Mataji, you are next.
Mataji, for me, it's like too much information, Mataji. It's very much inspiring, but I'm really telling it's too much information for me. Like, I have to listen one more time. You covered so much, Mataji.
Yeah.
But thank you so much, Mataji. Thank you so much for the wonderful class.
Thank you, Revati. Thanks for joining and giving us your association. That's really important for us. Thank you.
And I also felt the same thing, like how Revati Mataji said, Mataji, because sometimes I think that by reading a little bit, I can understand the Lord and put him in my pocket. But that's not the case. That's really not the case. Even the introduction is like this, then if it goes further, then... So at least we can understand God is great.
but yeah, it's yeah. like when you say, right, Mataji, it's like, like where are we, Mataji? I
exactly.
couldn't even able to comprehend anything, Mataji. But yeah, thank you so much for your time, Mataji. Thank you so much for the wonderful presentation.
Oh, thank yes. you so much, yes. Mataji.
You explained them in an understandable way, Mataji. Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Dandavat, Mataji.
Hare Bol.
Mataji, I mean, like they said, it's amazing plus amazing, Mataji. I don't know how to define it, but it's too much, Mataji. So much information. Two things I remembered, Mataji, when you were saying all these different levels, right, Mataji. The first one I remembered is an logarithmic table. You know, Mataji, so many levels, right, Mataji, chemicals, different levels, different colors. In my childhood, I used to hear logarithmic table. So that's one thing I remember. In recent days, after I started my software job, I remembered my algorithms and design patterns, Mataji. This is linked to that, that is linked to that, that is linked to that, and everything linked to something else. And some day there's abstract class, some day something else, some interface. It's like a product, it's like a opening out of the box code of a product, Mataji. Something like Oracle or some Sterling Commerce. But so when you were saying, Mataji, I could not follow the main. You were not talking very fast, Mataji, but still I could not follow because of my ignorance, Mataji. I was writing a diagram. Just arrows and everything, just to understand. It's so nice class, Mataji. Many new things I learned, Mataji, in this class. Especially Shambhu, I heard of that one, Mataji. But I never heard like Mahavishnu, from the right, Shambhu is coming from the left, Brahma is coming. Because all I heard was like from the Brahma in the material world, the Shiva comes. That much I know. I never heard other things, Mataji. Thank you so much. And thank you for clarifying that, Mataji. Rama Devi, actually inside Karana Rakshai Vishnu, but just for our understanding, it's put outside of Mahavishnu. That's a clear understanding, Mataji. Thank you. Because I was thinking every time they show in any Vishnu temple site, Mataji, only one guy, like even in Tirupati also. I used to ask them, like, where is Lakshmi, his concert? They say, okay, she is at his heart.
Yeah.
So now I didn't get this doubt before, Mataji, only after you said. Then I was thinking, yeah, shouldn't Rama Devi should be at the heart of Mahavishnu? Then again, you clarified, but now I'm connecting strings. Thank you so much, Mataji. Mataji, Purusha Sukta prayer said, Mataji, before the Shirasagar Madan, right? They do that one, right? So in nowadays, Mataji, does anybody say this, chant this Purusha Sukta, Mataji, any temples? Do they still have existence? Or?
Yes, Prabhu. Even now they chant, during Shaligrama Puja itself, they chant every day morning. At least generally men chant, Vedic Brahmanas chant, men chant, generally women don't chant, that's how the rules are. Even during in the temples also they chant, Prabhu. Like for in our house, we just put the tape when my Prabhu opens the Shaligram, but otherwise, because we don't chant, so we just put the audio tape, that's all. But they chant, Prabhu. They chant. I was actually thinking, last time Pani Hati Vedsa Prabhu made the boys chant, actually, for Shasasta.
I see. Sure, Mataji. Mataji, I couldn't hear properly, Mataji. You said there are two incarnations, Hamsa and Mohini. They don't have permanent spiritual planets. So they come to Mahavishnu. So in the return, where do they go, Mataji?
Again in Mahavishnu only they will be.
So they stay in Mahavishnu always.
Actually, if you look at it now, technically you cannot say coming, going also is difficult because in so many universes they are manifesting, right? But the thing is, their point of, you can say entry and return is Mahavishnu, or where they repose is in Mahavishnu, where they emanate. Yeah.
Oh, they don't go above Mahavishnu, so that's the last stop.
That is what I heard in Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj's seminar. I'm just quoting him directly because that's how he explained. Many of the incarnations, they repose in Mahavishnu who do not have spiritual planets in the spiritual world. That's how he said. Okay. And how do I know? He particularly mentioned Hamsa, but I've read in Srila Prabhupada's, I don't know, some reports and other places, he has mentioned at least two characters. One is Hamsa Avatara, one is Mohini Avatara. So both he has said they don't have spiritual planet. So that's why I included Mohini in the conversation.
Sure, Mataji. Mataji, that's all, Mataji. Thank you very much, Mataji. My brain is a little burning, Mataji, but still I digest it. It's too much, but it's like a good explore unless I write that one and hear again. I try to understand everything, Mataji. I put my effort.
Yeah, bravo.
Thank you so much, Mataji. I have no more.
Thanks. Okay, so thanks.
I think Vishwanthu, I think he was joining and at the sound, Mataji, dropping, starting.
He was joining and dropping. Who's 4702909909?
It's myself,
Mataji. Oh, okay. So you're on two numbers. Okay. Okay. I'll
What number? This is my only number, Mataji. Only number. Yeah.
Oh, that's your only number, okay.
Yeah, the other one is not for in use.
Okay, maybe the other one is Vishwan Prabhu only. But yeah, maybe he's just joining and dropping nonstop. Yeah. Okay, Prabhu, I don't think he has any questions. I don't think. Okay.
So then thank you, Mataji.
Yeah, thanks, Prabhu. So then we'll finish this call. Shall I press tab 9?
Yes, Mataji.
Hello?
Yes, Mataji. We didn't hear it stop, Mataji.
What should I do? Star 91, right?
No, not 91, Mataji. Just star 9.